It was a real honor for me personally to be able to go. We went to the little town called Wiggins, and it was a beautiful little town. But one of the neatest things for me was to have a chance to be with these students and adults that went. I had a privilege of serving, to have Shane Booker as my teammate, to have Misty Russ, and to have Sandra Chisholm. And those four have such servants' hearts. It was amazing to be with them during those days. And just to see anything I asked or anything that was needed, they jumped right on it. And it was a privilege to serve with you guys. But to be with these students was such a highlight for me. I wish that you could have seen and heard a lot of times what I would hear as we would get together as a group, and I would hear their prayers. And God taught me something great through them. I learned so much through their prayers, through our times of worship, and this their eagerness to say, God, here I am, send me. It taught me so much about the awe of God. It taught me so much about the humility and just having that servant's heart. And I thank you guys so much for that. There's no way I can express in words how much that means to me personally, to see what I saw in you during the week, just your hunger for God and your eagerness to serve Him. We have a great group here, and it's a reflection. I want to thank our parents. It's just an amazing thing to go and to see our students have such a hunger and to serve God and such just an eagerness. They had the most amazing attitudes. We did a lot of different things, and everyone was absolutely, they jumped right in. So it was a privilege. Tonight, several folks said, are you going to preach us a sermon? And no, tonight I want to share more of a devotional thought. It's one that I've had a chance to share before with our students, and it's one recently I had a chance to share at one of our local high schools. But it's something that God doesn't seem to let me get away from. I want to talk to you tonight on a subject that really goes against, or I guess you could say the definition is far different than the way our world defines it. When I was a kid growing up, I can remember I don't forget if I was around middle school, elementary age, but I remember when a guy that was 6'6" from North Carolina entered the NBA. His name is Michael Jordan. And I can remember at night I'd want to get through with my homework. I'd want to come in from outside of playing because I wanted to turn the TV on and see Michael Jordan play basketball. I'm not a great basketball player, and I don't know a whole lot about basketball, but in my opinion, he's the greatest that's ever picked up a basketball. He would do things on the court that just seemed to defy gravity. I can remember watching him each night, him do layups where he seemed just to float and glide through the air, or he would get a steal and he would do an amazing dunk. And I'm all white boy. I would get out of my yard and my basketball goal and try to do those things, and I didn't come close to what he did, but I tried my best to emulate those layup moves. And if I could lower my goal from 10 feet to maybe 7 or 8 feet, I would try my best to do those dunk moves. But as a kid, I looked at him as being truly great. I considered him, when I thought about greatness, I considered him to personify that. But tonight I want us to look at something that from God's Word, from an example that Jesus set, which really gives us a picture of true greatness. What I'm going to share with you tonight is a story you're very familiar with. I'm going to share principles with you, three principles to be precise, that they're nothing new, things that you've thought of, things that you know, but I really believe they're things that we need to take to heart. So I want to speak to you very briefly on the subject, true greatness. And if you have your Bibles, I would love for you to join me tonight in John chapter 13. John chapter 13, and we'll start in verse 1. And as you turn there, I know that you're familiar with the book of John. It's the book where it's written so that people may know that Jesus is the Christ, the Messiah. And by seeing, John laid out the book so that he would, several signs that Jesus did that pointed to him being God's Son, the Messiah, are distinguished or given in the book of John. And as we go through the book of John, it's written so that people may believe that Jesus is the Christ and put their faith in him. Well, one of the neat things about the book of John is it probably more than any other gospels, it gives us a clear picture of the heart of Jesus. As you see him interact with people from all walks of life, and in the passage we're going to look at tonight, as you see him interact with his disciples. In John chapter 13 through chapter 17, we find Jesus' farewell discourse to his disciples. Here in John 13, it's what's happening. It's the night before he would begin the false trials. It's the night right before he would be crucified. And here he is in the upper room with his disciples. It's a very intimate time. They're observing the Passover, and Jesus is going to implement something that we know now as the Lord's Supper. It's a time of intimacy, but it's also a time where Jesus has to be filled with anguish. We know that from Scripture as he knows what is about to happen. Interesting, as we look at this passage, I want you to keep in mind that when we put all the Gospels together, we get a clear picture or a clear picture of what took place that night, and especially what took place just preceding the events or what's going to take place here in our passage. We learn from the other Gospel accounts that the disciples had been arguing about who would be the greatest in the kingdom of God. Keep that in mind as we think about that subject, true greatness. They had earlier been arguing about who would be the greatest. Who would sit on Jesus' left and right? And so in verse 1 we read, "Now before the feast of the Passover, when Jesus knew that his hour had come, that he should depart from this world to the Father, having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. And supper being ended, the devil having already put it into the heart of Judas Iscariot, Simon's son, to betray him, Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands and that he had come from God and was going to God, rose from supper and laid aside his garments, took a towel and girded himself. After that, he poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and to wipe them with the towel with which he was girded. Then he came to Simon Peter, and Peter said to him, 'Lord, are you washing my feet?' Jesus answered and said to him, 'What I am doing you do not understand now, but you will know after this.' Peter said to him, 'You shall never wash my feet.' Jesus answered him, 'If I do not wash you, you have no part with me.' Simon Peter said to him, 'Lord, not my feet only, but also my hands and my head.' Jesus said to him, 'He who is bathed needs only to wash his feet, but is completely clean, and you are clean, but not all of you. For he knew who would betray him. Therefore he said, 'You are not all clean.' So when he had washed their feet, taken his garments, and sat down again, he said to them, 'Do you know what I have done to you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you say, well, for so I am. And if I then, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also to wash one another's feet. For I have given you an example that you should do as I have done to you. Most assuredly, I say to you, a servant is not greater than his master, nor is he who is sent greater than he who sent him. If you know these things, blessed are you if you do them." What I'd like for us to look at briefly tonight are three things. Three things that give us a picture of true greatness. Three ways, if we're going to be truly great in God's eyes, or we're going to be great from a kingdom perspective, three things that typify or personify this. The first one is if we're going to be great, if we're going to follow the example of our master, we must be willing to do insignificant and humbling tasks. To do insignificant and humbling tasks. In verses 4 and 5, we read once again, it says that Jesus rose from supper and laid aside his garments. He took a towel and girded himself. After that, he poured water into a basin, began to wash the disciples' feet, and to wipe them with a towel with which he was girded. What Jesus was doing by taking off his garments and girding himself with a towel, he was taking on the posture and the clothing or the apparel of a servant. His disciples in that first century, in that culture, would have known immediately what he was doing. And when he takes out the towel and begins to wash their feet, they would have known precisely what he was doing. He was taking on the role of a servant. He was taking on the role of a slave. That's why when he comes to Peter, Peter is upset. "Lord, you will not wash my feet." Because Peter knew that his master was taking on the form of a servant. It was offensive to Peter. But I would imagine as those disciples had earlier been arguing about who would have been greatest, it would have been like someone kicking them in the gut as they're going to see what greatness really is. You know, back in those days in the first century, that they didn't have nice tennis shoes and shoes oftentimes like we wear. But as they went along those dirty paths, most people wore sandals. Back in those days, slaves oftentimes went barefooted. And as they traveled along those dirty paths, just like today, as we walk along a dirty road, their feet would be filthy. And when they came into a house, it was common practice for someone to wash their feet. And this task, which only would make sense, was reserved oftentimes for the lowest and the most menial of slaves. So once again, they're arguing about who would be greatest. And Jesus is going to show true greatness. And when he begins to wash their feet, Peter would immediately recognize, my Lord is taken on the place of a menial slave and servant. And that's why he's offended. If we're going to follow the example of our master, if we're going to show true greatness, it means we need to be willing day in and day out to do humbling, insignificant tasks. Maybe to help someone that in our flesh we would just not want to help. Maybe do a job that just seems like that is not at all what I want to do. The last day that we were working there in Wiggins, we went to the house that some of our students mentioned, Mr. Larry, and we were doing vinyl siding. It was a house that Mr. Larry would share with a lot of the adults and others that there were so many holes that a lot of his daughter was just ashamed to get on the bus and get off the bus because kids would ridicule her as they saw just the condition her home was in. Well, you know, as we did that vinyl siding, that wasn't the easiest of jobs. And the truth is, in the world's viewpoint, it was an insignificant job. Our names will never be in any paper. We will never get any recognition. We'll never, you know, someone will say, well, look at what y'all did. Let's show this on the news. And that's all the much better. Because we did it out of a love for Larry, and we did it to honor our Lord. And we were willing to do some insignificant and humbling because we wanted to show Mr. Larry Jesus. And I can promise you, if you make the choice day in and day out to follow Jesus, he's going to lead you to do things that are insignificant and humbling for his glory. You'll get zero recognition. Your name will never be in the newsletter. Brother Craig will probably never say, let me point out so-and-so for doing this. But it's okay. Because Jesus notices. And we're doing it for him, and we're doing it for others. And even if we take on the most menial task or job, if he gets the glory, it's the greatest job. It's the greatest task. If we're going to follow Jesus, or if we're going to exemplify true greatness, again, we need to be willing to do insignificant and humbling tasks. But a second thing is we need to be willing to serve those who reject and even persecute us. Serve those who reject and even persecute us. Look with me again at verse 2. And it says, supper being ended, the devil having already put it into the heart of Judas Iscariot, Simon's son, to betray him. I can't get away from this thought. I never really noticed this. I've read this passage I don't know how many times, but until maybe several months ago when I was really studying through it. Jesus knew from the foundation of time that Judas would betray him. When he called Judas to be his disciple, he knew he would betray him. He knew that just very shortly Judas was going to go out and carry out his betrayal. You know that Judas would betray him for 30 pieces of silver, which would be the price of a common slave. But yet that night, Jesus, knowing that, it breaks my heart, but one of the folks that he knelt down and washed his feet was Judas. If we're going to be like our master and we're going to follow him, we need to be willing to serve those who even reject us, who persecute us, who may make fun of us. May totally misunderstand why did we do that. We might even ridicule our name. But we can never be like our master if we say no to that. So if we're going to show true greatness, again, we need to be willing to do the humbling task. We need to be willing to serve those who may reject us or persecute us. And then there's a third thing. We need to be willing to serve others consistently each day. To serve others consistently each day. Verse 12, we read again, so when he had washed their feet, taken his garments, and sat down again, he said to them, do you know what I've done to you? You call me teacher and Lord, and say, well, for so I am. If I then, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have given you an example that you should do as I've done to you. Most assuredly, I say to you, a servant is not greater than his master, nor is he who sent greater than he who sent him. If you know these things, blessed are you if you do them. Jesus himself said, I've come not to be served, but to serve and give my life as a ransom for many. Jesus' life was characterized by service. When we read through the Gospels again, we notice how day in and day out, he nearly worked himself to exhaustion serving people, ministering to people, healing people, caring for people. And I'm sure there's billions of things that he did that are not even recorded in the Bible where he was constantly serving people. We can never be like Jesus if we don't follow this example. But if we're to be Christ's followers, our lives, not just on a mission trip, not just when things are going great, not just when we feel spiritual, but our lives are to be characterized by service. When people at work or at school or in our neighborhood or people that know us, if you were to ask them, give me one word that describes this person, it should be they're a servant. There's an old saying that goes, we're never more like Jesus than when we're serving one another. And that is so true. Hold your spot for just a second. Turn with me to the book of Mark. Mark chapter 10. And let's start in verse 42. Mark chapter 10, verse 42. In verse 42, the verses preceding, we find out that James and John had just asked Jesus if they could sit in his left and right in the future kingdom, and the disciples are upset, they're angry about it. And in verse 42, Jesus says, he calls them to himself and says, you know that those who are considered rulers over the Gentiles lord it over them, and their great ones exercise authority over them, yet it shall not be so among you. But whoever desires to become great among you shall be your servant. And whoever of you desires to be first shall be slave of all. For even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life a ransom for many. As a follower of Christ, our prayer needs to be from the moment we wake up and all throughout the day, wherever we are, at work or at school, in our neighborhood, in our homes, is, Lord, I pray that through your grace and power that you will help me die to myself. You will help me die to me so that this day, this moment, wherever I am, it's not about me. I'm not thinking me, 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 me. Someone look at me. Someone help me. Someone do something for me. What about me? But Lord, through your grace and power that you would help me nail that to the cross. You would help me lay that down to the altar so that I can see people through your eyes. So I'm not thinking about me, 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 but I'm truly thinking about you and I'm thinking about the needs of others. Oh, how we desperately need to do that. We live in a world that's characterized. We live in American culture that says, it's all about me. And it's right if it's all about me, but the Bible says no. The Bible says we're to be a slave of Christ and a servant of others. The Bible says we're to think not highly of ourselves, but to put the needs of others above our own. And the Bible says that when we do so, as we see in John 13, we're being like Jesus. I tell the youth this some, but my prayer for myself, and I know many of you probably pray this already, but if you don't, I challenge you, is that just like I put on a pair of glasses to help me see, if I take these off, I can't see Mr. Rainey there in the back, but with them on, I can see him a little bit. But each day that you would say, Lord, just like I'd put on a pair of glasses, Lord, you'd help me put on your eyes. You would help me see people through your eyes. So again, I'm not thinking about the world revolving about me, but I'm thinking of others. I'm thinking of how I can meet needs. I'm thinking about how I could listen. I'm thinking about how I could care. I'm thinking about how I could practically love them so that I can show them to you, so that I can earn the right to share the gospel with them, so that I'm being like you. So what we see in John 13 is that true greatness doesn't come from being a superstar. True greatness in God's eyes doesn't come from being the most popular person in the world. It doesn't come from status or wealth. It comes from being a true servant. I pray that we'll be willing to do humbling and insignificant tasks day in, day out. That we'll even be willing to serve those who reject and persecute us. And that third, our lives will be marked by consistently serving Christ and serving others. At the close of World War II, as Brother Craig mentioned this morning, in war-torn Britain, an American soldier was driving his Jeep through town as so many of those buildings were destroyed, so much damage, so much heartache. And as he came along, he noticed a little pastry shop that was open in the midst of all the destruction. And as he got out of his Jeep, he noticed a little boy there with his face plastered to the window of the pastry shop. The little boy was just sad looking. His clothes were torn. His hair was messed up. He just looked like an orphan, someone that had no hope. And the little kid's face was just glued at what was taking in place inside that pastry shop. The American soldier went in and he bought a bunch of pastries. And when he came out, he said, "Son, would you like some?" And the little kid says something I'll never forget. He said, "Mister, are you God?" When we're willing to serve people, just like our middle school students did in Wiggins, Mississippi, just like Mr. Larry, the guy they shared with you, saw, they see God. They see who Jesus is. And I believe it opens the heart so they can hear who Jesus is. I pray that each of us will exemplify true greatness by following in the steps of our Master and Lord. Would you stand? I'd ask that you would bow your heads. I want us to have a short time of invitation, a chance for you to respond if God's leading you. Jesus said that he came not to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many. Jesus gave his life so that we could be bought, so that our sins could be paid for, so that the price and the penalty of sin could be paid and done away with. And he offers a gift that had an infinite price that only he could pay. He offers it to us. And maybe tonight you're like Miss Pat Holland and you need Christ. You need to meet this Savior who was willing to serve and go to the cross for you. You need him to be your Lord and Savior. Maybe you're here tonight and you know that you're a believer. But what God is saying to you is, I want you to be a servant. I don't want this world and your days to be focused on me. I want them to be focused on Christ and others. Maybe you just need to get along. Maybe nothing I've shared tonight is what's going on, but boy, God is just dealing with your heart about a decision, and you need to talk to one of our ministerial staff, or maybe you just need to come and make these steps on altar and just get along before God and meet with him and do business with him. I want to say a short prayer. When I say amen, it's your time. God's speaking to you. God's dealing with you about a decision. You come. Father, you know our hearts and lives. I pray that you will have your way. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. You come. You come.